Like I said at the beginning, I'm glad you're here with us. As we're going to be starting a new series today, and that learning how to be happy and what that means in our life. Because you see, so far in 2017, we said that if we understood and we've learned and we confess that if people really understood how much God loved them, they really understood that kind of love. You know, you couldn't keep them from wanting to come to worship and be there and to love God back. And remember, that's one of our purposes, is to love Him. And God says, I love you so much, I want you to be happy in your life. But it might not be happiness the way that we think happiness should be. It might not look like how we think it should look. But God knows exactly what we need. He knows exactly what's best for us and the best ways to be happy. And He says, look, if you'll take these steps, you're going to have happiness like you never imagined. Our problem is we keep trying to do it ourselves. And that brings problems into our life. You know, parents, I don't know if you ever remember this place and ever been to this place, if you had young kids and stuff like that, and that I've actually heard it called evil incarnate, and at times I could actually believe that statement. The place is called Chuck E. Cheese. So I don't, you know, you're laughing, that means, okay, you've been there. Maybe you've experienced what that place is. But in Chuck E. Cheese, and that they had this game at one time, because we used to take my kids there for their birthday parties and everything, you know, and try to leave them and all that stuff. They kept showing up and everything. But we'd play this crazy game, and maybe you've seen it. I know they had it at other places. It's called Whack-A-Mole. You ever seen Whack-A-Mole, play Whack-A-Mole? Yeah, the whole principle behind it, if you're not, is you see the game that's there. You know, they got this crazy game in front of you, you got some holes, and then there, a mole, when you put your money in, a mole will pop up, and they have some kind of hammer or whatever that you're supposed to smack the mole on the head and make it go down and go away. And the whole thing with the game is, once you hit this mole here, over here pops another one. So you go to hit that one, two pop up here, and you hit these, you know, and you get going with it. And it actually at times can be a very frustrating game, because you think you're winning and hitting all these moles and knocking them all down, and they keep popping up and keep popping up. And I don't know if you realize this, but whack-a-mole is a beautiful metaphor for life. Did you know that? I mean, think about this. You got this problem in your life, and you're dealing with this issue the way that you want to deal with it and how you want to deal with it. And you think you got it solved, and what happens? Boom, pops up another problem over here. So you go over here to this problem to do what you have to do. And just as you think you're getting under control or not, two more problems pop up under here. Whack-a-mole, a metaphor for life. Let's go home. We learned a lot today, you know. Forgot Charlie was here. He'd take me seriously. You know, but you know, and it really is when it comes to a lot of other areas on our spiritual side, our sins and our temptations. You know, we think we can handle it. We think we can control them. We get going and we get doing this, and they just keep popping back up. They keep popping back up, and it gets frustrating. And, you know, we try to do it with the things that are out there. We try to use them. You know, like we'll turn to self-help books. We'll turn to Dr. Phil and all those other kinds of things. And those things can help. But what they help with is they just help you learn how to swing the hammer maybe a little more efficiently or a little more quickly. But they don't stop from popping, from the moles popping back up. You see, that's what God's word does, if you allow me to stay with this metaphor. God's word teaches us how we can actually end the crazy game. That stuff isn't popping up all the time within our life. We just have to make sure it's not our way, that it's God's way. You know, and none of us are perfect when it comes down to this. And that's why we struggle with that. I mean, think about this. And as we start this series here, you know, we've done this before. Let's do mass confession. You don't have to raise your hand and all that when I ask these questions. Just think about your life and where you're at, you know, when it comes to some of these things. I mean, have you ever stayed up way too late when you knew you had to get up real early in the morning? You don't have to raise your hands. And you wanted to, yes. Yes, I have, Dad. Like I didn't know that. Yeah, that's my youngest son there trying to confess. He must want something. And so, you know, have you ever stayed up late and maybe when the alarm went off, you thought, oh, I want to go hear Pastor Dave, but I'm spending it with Pastor Pillow. Click. You know, instead. Or maybe you stayed up late and you came to church and slept through church. You know, have you ever noticed that, well, there's this food and it's got all these calories and maybe I shouldn't eat all these calories, but you can't help it and you do. Or maybe you felt like you ought to exercise, but you don't. Or have you ever known that you should be kind and that you should be unselfish, but instead you find yourself being unkind and selfish? Welcome to the human race. It's the struggles that we have in our life. And it's not just our struggles. It's not just something new to us. I mean, this goes all the way back. Remember what Paul, when Paul made the confession of his struggles of being human, when he said these words, he said, I don't understand what I do. What I want to do, I don't do. But what I hate to do, I end up doing. I know that nothing good lives in my sinful nature. I have the desire to do what is good, but I cannot carry it. On top of your outline there, there's a whole bunch of words that I placed there that I want to encourage you to take some time right now and look at it. When you see these words, are these things that you understand? Are these words that keep popping up, situations that keep popping up in your life, problems that keep popping up? This is like there's stress and there's fear and the need to control and all different things. If you look at those and think, yeah, I can relate. That's the stuff that keeps popping up in my life and popping up in my life. When you look at those things, the question comes is, what is it that causes all these problems? Because you see, every problem in our life has the exact same root cause. And you know what that is? It's playing God. You know? It's just playing God. And what we need to do, and what I hope we can start to learn, is we just need to get honest. We need to live in reality. We need to get real with ourselves. That when I decide that I'm going to choose what's best for me, I'm going to be playing God, and guess what's going to pop up? Those crazy, crazy things that are there. And it's the oldest temptation known to man. Did you realize that? Playing God, the oldest. Think about the Garden of Eden. Garden of Eden's created. God created Adam and Eve, and he shows them the whole thing, and he comes to them and says, look it, you got this whole playground. Have fun, party, enjoy the Super Bowl, whatever, and all that other kind of fun stuff. But right here, this one tree, do not eat of any of the fruit of this tree. Period. It's the only don't he pretty much gave to them. As soon as they leave, who shows up? The serpent, Satan. And he comes, and what does he say? Hey, if you eat of the fruit of this tree, you know who you're going to be like? God. It's interesting. Satan doesn't say, you're going to be like me. Because Satan doesn't want to convince us to be like him. Because he knows, you know, this deceit. He says, you will be like God. You'll have the knowledge of God. You'll be a God. I mean, there's a whole philosophy built around this today called the New Age movement, which says, hey, you're a God. And the New Age movement is actually, it's not new. It's the oldest lie ever told, and it deals with our pride. It hits us right at our pride. It's our oldest temptation. Ezekiel, he points us out. He says these words to King Tyree that I think he could probably stand at any church today and say these exact same things because we could understand and struggle. He says this, in the pride of your heart, you say, I'm a God. But you're just a man, not a God, though you think you are as wise as God. Doesn't that fit? And you might be sitting there thinking, well, yeah, I know some people at Fitz, Dave, but I got to be honest. I don't think I've ever claimed to be as wise as God within my life. So I'm not sure how that applies to me today. Well, I guess this is what I mean by that statement. And I guess this is what Ezekiel's trying to teach and keep before us. And that maybe words have never come out of your mouth that says, hey, I am as wise as God, the creator of this universe. I'm as wise as him. You might not have said those exact words, but I guarantee you, everyone in of us in here, probably at different times and in different ways, have felt that and have lived that. You see, when you're studying, when you're trying to figure out God, when you're trying to figure things out, you're trying to figure out life and a situation comes up and you look and you say, oh, well, I see that God says not to do that. I'm going to go ahead and do it anyhow. Or I see God says that this is what I should do. But I don't like it, so I'm not going to do it. You know what you've just done? You just decided that you know what's better for you than God does. You just started playing God. You've just decided and said, I'm wiser than God. I know what's better for me than God does. And you've fallen into that trap. That's why, like the writer of Proverbs, you see all over, but the writer of Proverbs specifically says, pride, it ruins people if we're not careful. We start to fall into this role. So when we hear all this that we're hearing right there, the question comes, well, then what's the cure, David? How do I get over this? And that's what I want us to spend the next 8 weeks doing. That's what I want to invite you to be coming back over the next 8 weeks as we look at what we call the Sermon on the Mount, the greatest sermon that Jesus ever gave. When he began it, he said, look it, I want you to understand, my Heavenly Father wants you to be blessed. And we've done studies here. The word blessed means happy. My Heavenly Father wants you to be happy in your life. Let me give you 8 things that if you do, as he starts this sermon out, you can be happy because he loves you. And because of that love, we should love him back. So let's look at the first one here today. The first beatitude that as we call it, that helps us know how to keep things real. It says this in Matthew 5:3. Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Now, what does that mean to be poor in spirit? That's what I want us to understand and learn today. Because we need to realize he's not talking about physical poverty. There is no blessing in being poor physically. He's talking about spiritual poverty. Recognizing my sinfulness, recognizing my hopelessness, recognizing my helplessness. God's word translation, it says it this way in the verse. Blessed are those who recognize that they are spiritually helpless. That's what he's talking about, you know. And God says if we can develop this attitude, you know, that I am powerless, that I need help, that I cannot control and manage everything in my life, that I need help. He says, if you can develop that attitude, then you're going to have this blessing. Then you're going to be poor in spirit. Then you're actually going to be happy. So how do we do that? How do we develop that attitude? I want to share three things with you. The first one I'm going to spend most of the time on. I'm sure you've heard all three of these things but I want us to spend some time and understand how do we develop the right attitude so we can have that happiness. The first thing it says, if you really want to be poor in spirit, if you really want to have the blessing and the happiness that God wants for you, then I have to humbly admit I need help. If you're taking notes, I hope you are. You and I have to humbly admit that I have to face the truth about me. I've got to stop living in denial. You know, I got to get real. That's why I titled this message, Let's Get Real. Because Jesus says, what is it that sets you free? The truth is what sets us free. So I have to face the truth. But the truth about truth is, I don't like the truth about me. I love hearing the truth about you. I can listen to that all day long, but I don't like it about me. You know, and even though Jesus says that's what's going to set you free from the bondage and everything there, that means I have to be miserable for a while I accept and humble myself and hear about this truth about me. But that's what I have to do. I have to admit I need help. I have to get real. I have to be honest. And the good news with this is, all those things on that list, all those frustrating things that keep popping up time and time again, if we'll take these steps, that can be the beginning of healing. The bad news is, it takes humility. It takes humility. But you have to humble yourself. James said it this way. God resists the proud and gives grace to the humble. What's grace? It's God's power to change. If you really honestly want to change your life and who you are and those things that keep popping up and that, then you have to be willing to humble yourself. But I know in grade school and junior high and high school, college, at whatever level, master's level, you know, and going for your PhD, I don't think that they have classes on humility. They don't have 101, how to be, you know. Actually, we're pretty much taught the opposite in the world. Put yourself first. You are the best. You got to look out for number one. That's more like what we get taught. But God says no. So I want to give you some things, you know, because we don't hear a lot how to be humble. If you're taking notes, I don't even think I gave you a place on your outline for this. I apologize for that. So right on the side or whatever and stuff like this. If you want to know how to be humble, here's four things we need to do to understand this. The first in that, you and I, we got to admit we're broken. We just have to get honest and admit, I'm broken, you're broken. Why? Because we live in a broken world, you know, that doesn't work perfectly. Our weather doesn't work perfectly. You know, the economy doesn't work perfectly. Our relationships don't work perfectly. Our bodies don't work perfectly. You know, we live in a broken world, and we have to be willing to admit that. That's why in Romans, as you're reading through Romans and you go through Romans chapter 8, you'll come across the words that say, you know, creation is confused. Creation is groaning. Why? Because it's confused. Everybody, man, it seems like when you look in our culture today, there are so many people that seem so confused, but everybody's confused. And I don't think it's anything new today. We're just living it, so it seems that way, you know. But people like, I don't know what to do. I don't know what I'm supposed to do. I don't know where I'm supposed to go, you know. We have confused attitudes and everything. We're confused about everything in life. We got people trying to be other people. Older people want to be young. Younger people want to be old. Well, we have women trying to be men. Men trying to be women. We have races that look at other races, say, oh, I like that race. I'm going to make myself look like and sound like that race. And all that isn't said to be judgmental. That's just the confusion because of brokenness that's there. And we need to stop and humble ourselves and say, no, I need to be who God made me to be in our lives. So I have to admit I'm broken if I want to be humble. Secondly, I have to understand if I'm not willing to admit, you know, and if I'm not willing to do this, that my secrets that I keep will make me sick. The secrets that I have within my life, the secrets that you have, if we're not willing to humble ourselves this way, it'll make, I mean, David, he experienced this himself, and he wrote about this. He wrote about this in the 32nd Psalm, and he said this: when I refused to confess my sins, I was weak and miserable, and I groaned all, you ever groan all day long, you know? My strength evaporated like water in the summer heat. Finally, I confessed my sins to you, and I stopped trying to hide them all, and you forgave me, and all my guilt is gone. When I hit it, I got sick. When I humbled myself, I got healed. Have you ever heard anybody say this before? It's not so much what you eat, it's what's eating at you. If you're tired all the time, if you're frustrated all the time, if you got all these problems that keep popping up, guess what? Maybe you need to stop and get honest and say, what is it that I'm trying to hide inside? Because my friends, hiding never ever works. When we hide a sin, when we hide a hurt, when we hide a fear, all it does is increases in our life. Because we hide it and say, nobody's going to know. I mean, yeah, we know God knows, but no one's going to know when it comes to, I'm not even going to admit to that. So that is there. And you know why you have the temptation and the sin? Because you don't have the power. I don't have the power. We don't have the power to overcome it. How many times have you heard me say, if you could, you would, but you can't, so what? Yeah, you don't. So we hide it inside, and we can't do anything about it. That's why we have the problem. We don't have the power, but yet we hide it inside. And all it does is increase and increase because it starts to take power over us. So I got to admit that I'm broken. And I got to get it out because otherwise it'll make me sick. But thirdly, we have to understand if we want to be humble, we have to admit it to defeat it. You know, I can't work on my sins in my life until I admit the sins in my life. Proverbs 28:13 says, you will never succeed in life if you try to hide your sins. So what? Confess them and give them up. Then God will show you mercy. God will show you mercy. Because if we don't take these steps, then we have to realize the fourth thing about this is my fear from taking these steps, my pride from taking these steps, it's going to keep me stuck right there where I'm at. Again, this problem is as old as man. After Adam and Eve decided to eat of that fruit, God came looking for them. What were they doing? Hiding. And when God found them and said, hey, why are you hiding? What was Adam's response? I was afraid because I was naked, so I hid. What's the very first problem there? What's the very first fear? The fear of exposure. And we still have that fear controlling us today. I'm fearful of people finding out who I am and what I'm going through. Take that all the way up to Matthew. Matthew 25, the parable of the talents. Not going to read it all for you, but talents are given to three different guys, you know. And the one that had just the one talent, he said this, I was afraid, so I hid my talent. People are still doing that today. You see, it's our pride. I don't want anybody to know my weaknesses, and it's our fear. I'm scared to death of my weaknesses, and that keeps us from getting well or healthy or whole or growing. It just keeps us stuck right where we are at. And we all have to understand, we are all in the same boat. How many times have you heard me say that over the years? We're all in the same boat as we sit in here together. I was at a youth conference once and heard a popular youth minister at that time speak. His name is Doug Fields. And Doug was talking about how he had a very religious, spiritual experience cleaning out his refrigerator once, came to this very profound theological truth. He said this, he said, some vegetables, when they go rotten, they let you know it. They let you know it, you know, and that. He said, like a potato. When a potato starts to go rotten on the inside, you ever smelled a rotten potato on the inside? You know that the crazy thing is rotten. But there's some things like an avocado. It can be just as rotten on the inside as the potato, but because of its shell and everything on the outside, it looks good, and it doesn't stink. The potato stinks, but the avocado doesn't. And Doug said, here's the point. Too many Christians live like the avocado. You know, they're like, well, just because you can't smell my stink, you know, and all that. And there are some sins, there are some frustrations, there are some problems, some issues that you can tell. You might not be able to tell the man that's struggling with lust and pornography, but you might be able to tell the man that's struggling with drugs and alcohol because it's just more prevalent what it does to the body. But guess what? They're both equally rotten. Just because one doesn't stink or you can smell the stink of the other one before yours, God says, we're both rotten. For all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. We're all in the same boat, you know? And we need to make sure that we're taking these steps because, well, look at it. We do the comparison game. We fall into it. I don't stink. You can't see me. You can't see my rottenness. So therefore, I don't need to take these steps that we just learned about. And God said, wow, no, that's not the reality. You know, everybody, we're all broken. We're all equal. But because of our pride, because of our fear that keeps us stuck, you know what we want to do? We want to play God. And we want to try to fix it ourselves. And Jeremiah said, oh. God spoke through Jeremiah saying, no, that doesn't work either. Jeremiah 2:13. My people have committed two sins. One, they have forsaken me, the spring of living water, the one who can give them everything they need to be happy in life and all the answers to work with, that they've forsaken me. And two, they have dug their own broken wells, their own broken cisterns that can't hold water. See, what he's saying is not only they rejected God, but they've tried to do it on their own to fix it themselves. And it don't work. It doesn't even hold water. You ever sat back and take a look at all the things? It's amazing if you sat back and take a look at all the ways that people try to fix themselves to get help instead of God. You know, astrology, crystals, you know, reading your palm. They'll go for all these fads and therapies and conferences, you know. They'll listen to all these tapes, go to these motivational seminars. They'll read book after book after book, and they'll believe some pretty crazy things. Try everything except God. We're building our own wells. Our wells are cracked. God says they don't work. They don't hold water. So the first thing that I have to do, the first thing that we need to do if we want to be poor in spirit, we have to humbly admit, we don't have it all together. We just got to be willing to humble ourselves, have that humility and say, I don't have it all together. But then the second thing we need to do is we need to turn to somebody who does have it all together. We need to say, we need to stop and we need to ask God for help. Ask God for help. If you want to have the blessing, if you want to have the happiness in that. It's what Paul talks about and challenges with in 2 Corinthians 1:9 when he said it like this. We despaired even of life itself. We saw how powerless we were to help ourselves. You know what that is? That's what we just learned, the first step. I need God. But that was good, for then we put everything into the hands of God who alone could save us, for he can even raise the dead. Did you hear what Paul said there? We couldn't help ourselves. We put everything in the hands of God. My friends, that's called total surrender. And that's what the church needs to get back today because we've lost that word total in front of the word surrender. We might say, hey, you know what, Dave, you're right. I'm going to humble myself and confess and admit I struggle with my finances. I can't keep track of them. They're not well, they're not good. So, but you know, all these other areas of my life that I'm playing God, I've gotten control. That's good. So I'll surrender my finances to God, but I'm going to keep control of these. And God says, no, it doesn't work that way. I put all in the hands of God. I come to God, I humbly admit I don't have it, and I ask him for help. Again, I love the message paraphrase of this first beatitude in Matthew 3 that we just read. It says like this, you're blessed when you're at the end of your rope. How many of you actually felt blessed when you're at the end of your rope, you know? But it says you're blessed when you're at the end of your rope. Why? With less of you, there's more of God and his rule. So I admit, I get real, you know? I get real, I get honest, I admit, I can't do it, and I need God's help in that. But the third thing that I need to do, I must humbly accept help from other people. How many times have you heard me talk about this in church before, you know? See, here's what I guess I want us to, I keep it before us because I want us to continue to understand this. You know that problem that we're trying to get rid of, that temptation, that fault, that worry, that loneliness, whatever it is within your life? We will never get rid of it on our own. What did I just say a few minutes ago? If you could, you would. But you can't, so you don't. You know? You don't. You're not going to get well unless you get honest with yourself, get honest with God, and get honest with others. Get real with others. And I know exactly what you're thinking, because I think the same thing when I hear this taught. I don't want to do that. And then the next question that follows that up, why do I need to do that? That's just total insanity. Why? You know? And the reason why? Because it humbles us. And God gives grace to the humble. It's our fear and our pride that keeps us stuck. But we have to remember, we were created for each other. We need each other. Remember Ecclesiastes 4:9? Two are better than one because they have a good return for their work. If one falls down, his friend can help him up. But pity the man who falls and has no one to help him up. We're wired that way. 58 times in the New Testament you see one another. Love one another. Help one another. You know, share with one another. Support one another. Counsel one another. Guess what that's called? That's called being the church. And that's what it means. As we come together, we're created. Even so much so that God knows that he created us for each other and that we need each other to lean on, to call upon. God says, people, I created you that way. And even when people don't believe in me, they need to have friends that will be there for them. When someone's in despair, Job 6:14 says this, a despairing man should have the devotion of his friends even though he forsakes the fear of the Almighty. God says, when you come to the end of that rope, when you've had it, when you're down, when you're frustrated, I've done. I can't do it anymore. I could care less about the church. I could care less about God. I really don't believe in him. As far as I know, you know, this is where he could do whatever and go. God says, even those kinds of people need to have, I created the thing to have those people that will come around them and say, well, you know what? Don't worry. We believe in you. Don't worry. And we'll believe in God for you right now. And we will walk beside you. We will what? Do life together. We'll carry you through this as we come. That's what it means to be a brother and sister in Christ, the family of God, the church. We will be there. We were created for that. We need people like that in our church. We need to be those kinds of people, and we need to have those kinds of people within our life. I mean, it's awesome what you're doing here this morning. You know, coming to church as you are and worshiping God, being, you know, coming together corporately and being in his presence. Turn to your neighbor and give him a high five. You know, just give him a high five. Because it's awesome, you know. You're doing good. This is great to come and remember around the table. Take those elements and remember what God has done for you. You know, to give back a portion that's there. To hear, okay, you can stop now. To hear this, should have known better. To hear the scripture, you know, quoted about who God is, how much he loves you. This is awesome. This is what you need to do. I encourage you, don't stop doing this. But if this is all we do, we're hurting still. I mean, think of it this way. I heard this illustration put up this way. Say on Sundays, every Sunday at 10 a.m., you went to some place and had that had a smorgasbord. And from 10 to noon, you ate. You could graze, stuff. During that two-hour period, you ate what you wanted and as much as you wanted. And then at noon, you stopped. And you didn't eat again until 10 a.m. the next Sunday. What would your week be like physically? What would your body be going through? You eat all week long every day because you need the nourishment and to give you the strength to go through what you have to go through every day. And God says spiritually, if you just come to church, that's a great start. But you need all week long to be with people, talking with people, praying with people, being in God's word, because you need the spiritual strength to face this world that's out there each and every day. Each and every day. James said this about admitting and about understanding our relationships in 5:16. Admit your faults to one another and pray for each other so that you may be healed. What's the key to healing? Right there. Admit your faults to one another and pray for each other so you might be healed. When somebody comes to me and says, Pastor Dave, I got something I want to tell you, and I've never ever told this to anybody else before. I know they are on the road to recovery. You know why? Because when we come and we open those that closet door, we let all that junk start to come out for the very first time, you know, that boogeyman come out, we realize that junk isn't as powerful as we thought it was. That boogeyman isn't as big as we thought he was, and that we all of a sudden start to have peace. We start to have healing. We start to have hope. Why? Because we're admitting. And you know what people usually follow up after they've done that and they've taken that step? You know what the words after they have that I hear them say? Usually when we're leaving, they give me a hug or we're talking and praying. You know what they say to me? Why didn't I do this before? why did I wait so long to take these steps? Because that what they felt was a relief. They felt that healing in that. They felt that in that. Just that admitting. Why? Because the moment that you do that, you humble yourself, and God gives grace to the humble. It's the hardest step for some of us because it really hits our fears and it really hits our pride. 10 fingers pointing right here. I see, in other words, you could sit there and say, yeah, I don't mind telling God and confessing my sin to God. I don't mind talking to God about my temptation. I don't mind talking to God about my fear, but I ain't talking to anybody else about those things. No way. And God says, I'm sorry, you know, because of that fear, because of that pride, you'll be stuck where you are and you're not going to get well, and you will never get well on your own because that's not how I created you. God has wired us that we need each other. We need him and we need each other to grow in our life, you know? Yes, go to God for forgiveness, but go, if you want to be healed, go and start telling other people when it comes to that. You don't have to tell everybody. You don't have to call up on the Goodyear blimp and have it, you know, advertise at the Super Bowl tonight, hey, look at here, you know, here's Georgia's sins, you know, and all this other kind of stuff coming across that with it. You know, you don't have to do that. You don't even have to come before the church and let it all out there. You can do that. Just find that one person, or maybe two people, you know, that aren't going to blabber, the one that you can build a relationship, that you know that can trust. They're going to love you unconditionally. When you come to them, they're going to say, oh, yeah, me too. Wow, been there, done that. Or maybe if they haven't been there, done that, they'll say, wow, yeah, it's going to be tough. But we're going to work through this together. We're going to work through this together. Because if you're serious about actually being changed, if you're serious about wanting change to come into your life, then we're going to have to learn to overcome that fear. We're going to have to learn to overcome that pride and humble ourselves the way that we learned about here today. And when we take those steps, then blessed are the poor in spirit. And we'll be there and we'll face that and we'll deal with that. And God's grace and God's strength will be there to walk us through. You see, honestly, let me make a confession here. As the worship team comes to lead us in some more songs to sing to this God that loves this. My biggest hurdle, my biggest struggle, I understand this personally, you know, to holiness and that, it's my desire to look good. And I'm not talking about the clothes I wear. I mean, they speak for themselves. You know, that's not what I'm talking about. I'm talking about I want people to like Dave. I want people to think that Dave is a good guy. You know, I don't want them to know what Dave thinks at times. I don't want them to know how Dave actually feels at times. I want them to think I'm an all-around Jesus every moment I'm awake all the time kind of guy. Thankfully, over the past several years, I've been a part of a small group, and I have several friends that I meet with regularly, that I'm not Pastor Dave to them. I'm just Dave, you know? That I can come to them and I can share. I mean, they accept me warts and all. See, they've gotten to know me and they know that there are times I'm not even close to Jesus. You know, they know that I have mess ups. They know that I have sin. They know that I have hurts. They know that I hurt. They know that they know that, and they love me and accept me for who I am. They know I don't have it all together, and I can share my fears. I can share my faults. I can share my sins. Everybody needs a place like that. And I really, really, as your pastor, I really want you to have that release. I really want you to have that freedom and that relief that we talked about here today, but you're only going to have it if you deal, if you'll get honest, if you'll get real about this pride, about this fear. It's the only way we're going to get, if we get honest and get real about being poor in the spirit. And as the worship team comes out here again, before we sing, I want to take some time and pray. And my only challenge to you this morning is to take a look as we pray and ask the Holy Spirit to look at your heart. Is there pride that's there? Has it helped you? Has it hurt you? Is there fear? Has it helped you? Has it hurt you? In your walk and in your relationship and being who God wants you to be, then maybe today's the day that you can just come forward and say, you know, I am struggling with this, and I don't want this within my life. And I just want the family of God praying for me so this is out of here, so I can become poor in spirit and receive the happiness that God wants. Start taking the steps that God wants me to take within my life. We're going to pray, and while we're singing, if that's you, I'll be up here. If someone's up here with me, come on up, keep coming. We got other leaders that can come, and we can just celebrate and start doing life together so we can be poor in spirit. Amen. Let's go before God. Lord, thanks. Thanks that you know us, you created us, you love us, as we always confess, and are so thankful for that, Heavenly Father. And I thank you that, Lord, you did. God, you sent your Son to share those beautiful words, that beautiful words of encouragement, of what it means, of what life can look like, of how we can have true happiness within our lives. Forgive us. Forgive us when we have forgotten that. Forgive us when we let fear and pride get in the way. Forgive us when we try to do it ourselves, when we think we are better or wiser or no more than you, Heavenly Father, even when we don't know that, Lord. We just come before you now, and I thank you for this family, the blessings upon blessings we have seen at the times that we have stood up, the times that we have been there, the times that we have confessed, the times that we've cried out, all of those things, Father God, and I pray that we can continue to do that, Lord, in our life, so we can continue each and every day to fall more and more in love with you, Lord. I thank you again for this time, and just, Lord, I ask that your Holy Spirit speak to each and every one of our hearts. Help us to see, are we letting fear, are we letting pride getting in the way of the steps that we need to take so we can, Father God, receive the happiness, the blessings that you want for us. Lord, if we are, then I pray that you give us the strength and the wisdom to know the steps that we can start taking now, Father, to remove that, Lord. Thanks again for this day that you have made, Lord. Now just hear our hearts as we continue to sing out and surrender to you. In Jesus Christ's name we pray. Amen. Please stand as we sing.